Security at Williamtown RAF base is always tight, according to senior Air Force officers. It's just that you can't always see it. Today, that story was markedly different. All visitors were undergoing a thorough vehicle search before passing beyond the perimeter. The delays caused by the inspection also slowed commuter traffic outside the base, resulting in angry complaints from motorists running late for work. However, the RAF says the system will be running more smoothly by tomorrow.
In future, of course, we'll have the traffic better organised so that people going past won't be interfered with, and also we'll have our search procedures much better organised.
The tightened security is part of the base's commitment to Operation Pitch Black, a war game being conducted in Australia's far north. The base has sent two Hornet squadrons to take part in the war games, but the need for realism is just as important back on the base.
If we are actually defending Australia on Australian soil, certainly every Defence Force base would be at a high state of alert.
The heightened security also poses a serious threat to anyone foolhardy enough to trespass during the exercise. The base is being patrolled, as always, by guard dogs who demonstrated an all too convincing enthusiasm for the war games. Trespassers fortunate enough to be rescued from the guard dog's fangs can at least expect to spend some time in the cells before civilian police take over.
Any 18-year-old with a handicap of just 3 is bound to be the envy of his golf club. But Paul Field is setting his sights much further down the fairway. Perth, in fact, where he'll be revelling in the atmosphere of the Australian Open amateur titles.
Oh, I think if I play at my best, I might be able to make the qualifying for the match play.
And it's just a bit of a trip for experience for you then?
Yeah, it should be good experience.
He'll be joined by 16-year-old giant Kurt Lind, a four-handicapper whose natural laziness keeps him on the green rather than the basketball court.
I'd like to go further, and I'd like to get turned pro, professional ranks and do all that stuff.
Why golf, not basketball?
Too much energy for that game.
Completing the trio is 21-year-old Darren Griffin, a former Australian sub-junior champ with a handicap of 1 and the ability to make a real impression should he qualify to take on some of the nation's more fancied youngsters.
Yeah, I've played against a few of them before and they're very good players. I'll have to play at my best, I think, to do any good over there, but hopefully that's the case.
The amateur crown has been worn by the likes of Bob Shearer and Brett Ogle. You can bet these three would just love to follow in those sort of footsteps.
Last week we brought you this story from the United States about a house being constructed from styrofoam. The technique, which originated in Germany, has now made it to the Hunter region. Local builders Kevin Hodgson and Jim Court of Adol Constructions are not the first builders in Australia to trial the method, but they are pioneers in using the styrofoam technique for footings as well as walls.
There has been different forms of construction with different materials, with the walls and the footings acting as one unit. But not using the same material all the way down into the ground.
The metre-long styrofoam blocks are imported from Germany, reinforced with steel and then filled with concrete. This section is being trialled at the University of Newcastle to determine how it compares with conventional footings. Already it has major advantages.
You don't have the formwork problems. The formwork we're using here is actually going to form part of the insulation in the wall. It's also going to be a nice smooth surface to put all our finishings on, such as renders and gyprock linings, plasters and things of that nature.
The bricks not only provide insulation but are earthquake and mine subsidence proof and also act as a fire retardant. Once this profile passes Australian standards, Adol Constructions has big plans for the technique in the Hunter.
Providing we can get everything passed okay with the council, intend to perhaps put a specy up and see how it goes. Approach the mines, of course, to see what interest they might have in it.
Jody McKay, NBN News.
The Newcastle Jockey Club today conducted a 12-event non-TAB program to be followed by tonight's extravaganza, a 10-event full TAB card, including the celebrity hurdle.
It's something different for Beaumont Park, and we've never had a winter meeting here, and the celebrity hurdle's created quite a deal of interest, and I read in the form guide that you might be a chance. No bunny at this track.
Well, there's only one guarantee, John, that there will be a rabbit win this race.
Well, there might be a surprise tonight without giving away any secrets. Mike, just look that you don't see double on the home turn.
An early market shows the NBN team clear favourites for the 485-metre journey, and the form guide of the relay team is impressive. Chris Barth, a flashy looker, all eyes will be on her. Alison Peters always leaves her opposition breathless. Scott Beffen, experienced performer, never beaten in a photo finish. And yours truly is no bunny at this track. For the serious punters, Gary Harley suggests you have a lash at Shandy Ann, number 8 in race 7, the Wallumbai Tavern Marathon, over the long 887 metres.
More than 200 heart attack patients are admitted to the Belmont Hospital each year. The hospital claims their chances of survival and recovery are twice as good as anywhere in the country thanks to a small dedicated staff labouring with quality but until now outdated equipment. Their latest acquisition is a $40,000 stress testing unit bought with funds raised by the Belmont 16 footers and Rotary clubs.
This equipment will enable us to differentiate between chest pain due to heart attacks and due to other causes of chest pain. It's also very important for our coronary care rehabilitation program.
The hospital would not have been able to afford the electrocardiogram or treadmill without the support of the community.
We're very aware of the fact that Belmont Hospital Coronary Care Unit is a totally community-funded unit. It was built with community funds in the first place, and we're very proud of the community that they've supported us in renewing some of our equipment.
The fire started on the eastern side of the Maitland Railway line at Sandgate and raced across swampland to a construction company's storage yard. Site sheds in the yard were ablaze when firefighters arrived, and the flames had begun climbing a bank toward the nearby convalescent home. 11 sheds packed with building supplies and tools were lost. Firefighters heard a number of explosions as they tried to save the buildings. Extra water had to be trucked in, but the wind was the main problem. At times, visibility was cut to zero as smoke and debris filled the air.
With the high winds, the corrugating iron was flying around, which was hampering firefighting activities very dramatically.
Four brigades brought the blaze under control and finished off the demolition of sheds claimed by the fire. The buildings and their contents, owned by FH Compton & Sons Constructions, were valued at about $50,000 and were insured.
The theme of the street pageant was Dance Through the Ages. Students from kindergarten to year 9 traced the steps of the caveman through to the modern era. The performance was the finale to Horizons 1991, a week of theatre, poetry, painting and various other activities organised by the school. The community was also invited to take part in the programme.
It gives the community a chance to come in and see what we're doing at Bulladilla Central School. It's a chance for us to bring in visiting schools from around the district. We're a small school, and I think, quite frankly, a lot of them don't realise just how much we've got to offer.
By all accounts, Horizons 91 was a great success. Jane Anderson, NBN News.
Western Suburbs earned the right to play in this year's grand final by thumping South in the major semi-final, while the Toronto Workers Scorpions did the same to the Lions in the preliminary final. For the players, a nervous 48 hours before the big one. For the supporters, time to get into the spirit of the occasion. At New Lambton, a very subdued build-up to Sunday, but I suppose if you have been in the decider 21 times before, it's old hat. However, the expectations and nerves abound in Rosella territory.
New Lambton always is a quiet build-up at this area. We're only a village, we're not a suburb. But the shopkeepers will be all behind us, the banks are behind us, the building societies, and I think you'll see a record crowd there on Sunday to what I believe will be a terrific game of football.
As for the game itself, West are confident but wary of Toronto.
We've put the performances in on the field all year, and we think we're entitled to feel confident, but grand final football is a different game, and Toronto workers have certainly deserved their place there, and they'll be hard to beat.
Out the Lakes way, pandemonium has broken loose, but after a drought of 31 years, why not a bit of self-indulgence? Even the old club song has been dusted off for a rerun. The hard work is at the Commonwealth, so you can bank on a Scorpion win. From the Shane Tobin Supporters Club to Babes in Arms, it's the green and gold forever.
Well, it'd have to be Toronto, wouldn't it? It has to be.
Well, as long as they don't go out and do what they done last week against South, give them 14 start, then they'll do a good job.
Fullback David Hill, sprucing up before the big event, is pretty confident. And for hard-working President Ken Royal, who won't hear of defeat, it's just been a super year.
Oh, excellent, yeah. Great performance, and Mel's done a tremendous job with the guys to achieve what they've done so far, and it's not finished yet, in 12 months is astounding.
Come 5 o'clock Sunday afternoon, who will it be? The Rosellas or the Scorpions? The strong Westerlies played havoc for both teams, but each had first half opportunities. Jonas made a great run, onto Bock who pinched it, but Ross Wells couldn't finish. At the other end, Anthony Beckett made space, but his floating cross was just wide, and it was nil all at the break. Chapman put Peter Oberhauser under pressure early in the second half, but the best chance of the match came to Western. Beckett did well to again make space, and his shot hit the crossbar and rebounded away. As normal time was coming to an end, Adamstown's Ross Wells again put the keeper under pressure, but he saved well and it was nil all at full time. $280 from all states in Australia have been in Newcastle for the national titles, and New South Wales has dominated. In the team's event, it was a clear-cut win to the home state, looking resplendent in their red jackets and shirts. Defending champions Victoria were second in the team's event. It is the 22nd Australian Championships and the second time that they have been held in the Hunter Valley, and according to organisers, it's been one of the most successful carnivals ever held. In the prestigious events, the singles, New South Wales again had their fair share of success. In the men's, it was a win to Dave Speechley, 18-16, on the 22nd end. The ladies' event went to Renata Gurk of New South Wales, 17-12, after a great struggle. In a surprise result, Tracy Cowan of the home state triumphed over Gail Thomas of Queensland, 20 shots to 14. And in the boys, it was a win for Tasmania, with Hamish Gadsby winning 18-12. In the past presidents, Arthur Brown of Cardiff was too good for clubmate Ron Hughes, 16-15.
Since 1985, the Japanese corporation Sumitomo has held the world record for the most steel cast in a month, belting out 151,891 tonnes. But that record has now been cast aside by the BHP. At the Newcastle Works last night, the Bloom caster brought its August figures to 153,278 tonnes. The 150 workers in the casting section say the world record was forged from much more than fire and steel.
EnviroFest is the region's first festival devoted entirely to the environment. Scores of stalls and displays were set up around the park, advocating the environmental message of reduce, reuse and recycle. The highlight of the day was the announcement of this year's Environmental Enterprise Search. Kathy Sale of Cardiff took out the award with her idea of using waste paper to manufacture lightweight house bricks. Pulped paper, cement, additives and colouring are mixed together, moulded and left to dry. The result, a brick one-third the weight of a normal brick. EnviroFest wasn't limited to Spears Point Park. Around 500 people took on the Walk for Wilderness, a national event to raise money for the Wilderness Society. It's hoped up to $6,000 will be raised from the 20-kilometre walk around the eastern side of Lake Macquarie. And still on environmental issues, a public meeting was held at Redhead this morning to discuss the upgrading of the Belmont sewerage plant. Residents are concerned that once the new plant comes online as part of the Westlake sewerage scheme, Redhead Beach will become even more polluted, a claim denied by the Water Board.
A massive crowd had gathered at Harker Oval to see if the Scorpions could achieve a first, win a grand final, and their forwards were on top in the early exchanges with some big hits. Desperate defence by Toronto saved more than one try in their first half, but finally the Rosellas found a way through. Crawford kicked a penalty to put Toronto on the map, and then right on the half-time siren, the points they were looking for. The Rosellas needed to score early in the second half, and their prayers were answered. But mistakes were starting to creep into West play, and David Steptoe was Johnny on the spot. Ten all, and with both kickers offline, a try was going to give one team the edge, and that was the green and gold. Law McDougall allowed frustration to enter his game plan and was lucky to see out the grand final, while Kevin Maher was cool in the crisis. And it was the brilliant second rower that helped the Scorpions to history. With the sound of the final siren, pandemonium at Harker Oval as the celebrations began for a victory that had taken 31 years to achieve.
Huge community interest in the project was indicated by the size of the crowd, all anxious for Shire President Warren Williams to cut the ribbon and unlock the door. Many of those among the first to stream inside for a look were not even born throughout the years of controversy about how big it would be, where it would go, and who'd pay the bill.
But it's fair to say that that's probably the downside. The top side of that, of course, is that had we built it 25 years ago, we'd have had nothing like we have today, and so I'm quite happy that we did procrastinate as long as we did.
In all, it cost $2.5 million, and the complex caters for 8 sports. As well as the 8-lane pool, there's a toddler's area and spa, a gymnasium, a basketball stadium and tennis courts. The state and federal governments provided $100,000 each, the local Memorial Services Club $50,000, and a massive $220,000 was raised by a funding committee. The remainder comes from council grants and loans. Hoping to attract national attention for the complex, the council now wants it recognised by the government as a regional swimming centre.
We have excellent transport arrangements, adequate accommodation for any number of people, and a magnificent place to come to, quite apart from the fact that we now have probably the best indoor swimming centre in country New South Wales, if not the state.
Jenny Lydiard lives opposite the Pasminco sulphide plant. Tests by the Department of Health show that soil from her backyard contains 13,700 parts per million of lead, a figure 45 times that regarded as safe by the National Health and Medical Research Council. But most frightening is the lead content in the dust taken from her baby son Jacob's room. At 9,840 parts per million, it is 33 times the safe level.
The levels that we've got are isolated ones, and we don't know how typical they are of the area around here, but some of them are high.
Yeah. Is it cause for concern?
Yes, it is, certainly.
9-month-old Jacob is not allowed to play in the yard of the Lydiard house or crawl about the floor. Instead, he's confined to the playpen, which is relatively free of dust. But even with these precautions, the level of lead in Jacob's blood is 24 micrograms per decilitre. The danger level for children over one is 25. The Department of Health has advised Jenny to have the house decontaminated. Until that's done, Jenny has to take special precautions.
I have to mop every day. I have to, I'm not allowed to use a broom at all because that just stirs up the dust. I have to wet dust rather than dry dust. I cannot vacuum with Jacob in the room. It's pretty hard because you can't put him outside either because the soil's contaminated.
While Dr. Stevenson admits the lead levels in and around the Lydiard's house are extremely high, he says it's too early to comment on lead levels overall in Boolaroo and surrounding suburbs.
We're really waiting for the results of tests which are based on a grid sampling across Boolaroo and Argentan, and we expect those back in about 4 to 6 weeks.
Jenny and other concerned residents have formed an action group called No Lead. Their first public meeting is on Wednesday night. Jodie McKay, NBN News. Jane Varco graduated from Newcastle University at the top of her mechanical engineering class. As the only female, she believed she had something to prove.
I wanted to prove to everyone that a woman could do equally as well as a male in this career.
Today, all that hard work was rewarded with the announcement that she'd won the prestigious Young Engineer of the Year award run by the Australian Institute of Engineers. Jane believes it is the engineering profession which gives the world a sustainable future. Her position as Process Control Superintendent at Alcan allows her to play a vital role in environmental protection.
Well, for example, some of the products that we may not have used before, we're now looking at using those as fuels or seeing where other industries can use those. Or for example, taking some of the raw materials that we buy, instead of buying them in small paper packages, we now buy them in large bags that can be sent back and refilled.
Thank you.